Let me introduce the speakers of the second presentation of this session, Jai Gauri Shivakumar and K. Neeraja. About Jai Gauri Shivakumar, she is working in NMKRB Degree College for Women at Bangalore. She completed her PhD from Indian Institute of Science and her thesis entitled Local Area Teacher Groups, a New Paradigm for Teacher Development in Higher Education. She is an active member of ELTC, a TD group in Bangalore, and presented papers on TD groups, teacher initiatives, and reflective teaching. Apart from this, she is on many boards of studies and is currently involved in textbook designing at Karnataka State Board of Schools and with the first English language policy think tank focusing on CPD for English language teachers. And about the second speaker, K. Neeraja, she is a retired professor from Maharani Lakshmi Ammani College. She is an active member of ECTC. She has more than 35 years of teaching experience, and her areas of interest is CPD. Today, they are going to present the paper on aspects of ethnography, evaluating continuous professional development.
Good afternoon, friends. Now I've got this thing ready, and I think I'm now ready to begin. I'd like to talk about aspects of ethnography, evaluating the continuing professional development of teachers. I'd like to lay the foundation for this. I've been a member of a TD group called the ELTC Bangalore, which was quite active and alive and kicking right from early 80s till about maybe late 90s or mid 90s. And after that, there has been a lull. Of course, both of us have been members of that group, and I finally decided to do my PhD in this area as well, looking at teacher groups and trying to see how they give you a platform for professional development. And I thought it's time I did something about it and put it in a more publicly available way. So the purpose of this paper, as I told you, would be to check whether or to discuss this to see whether ethnography would be a suitable framework for continuous professional development of teachers. We might be limiting our discussion to two contexts. One is the context of teaching and learning in the context of the classroom, and the other is the idea of peer observation. So most of our talk would be, I think, restricted to these two, the context of teaching and learning in the context of the classroom and the peer observation. The idea of evaluation and assessment has been something that has troubled me right from the time I've come here, and I was trying to see which aspect of assessment or evaluation I would like to look at. And after having listened to so many people for the last 3 days, I've quite liked the idea of Sue Hackett in the morning yesterday's presentation, where she spoke of assessment as a set of processes based on which we learn, make inferences about learners' learning, process, progress, and product. She said it was from Carrie Smith, 2004. I like that because there are these three concepts of process, progress, and product. And that, for me, was something that was intriguing. And while Neeraja and I were talking about this, we were also wondering whether we in ELTC, over a period of time, whether we made this kind of distinction. That, and also another thing that was drawn to my attention was, I've been loosely using the word continuous, and I think it was Rod Bulaito yesterday when he spoke of continuing. So I think there is a slight difference there, and we thought assessment would be what we do for ourselves in the context of teaching and learning, when we assess ourselves, when we wonder why something went well or didn't go well in our classroom, how come this worked in this classroom and didn't work in another classroom. And evaluation would probably be episodes of such thing over a period of time. So I felt that maybe this is, so the latter probably would be continuing professional development. When you have one phase or one cycle of growth may be followed by a kind of a leveling out and then continuing forward. Okay, so let's begin with this idea of ethnography. I'm sure this word, I did hear a lot of people using this, and I've just given a very simple definition of the word ethnography. Ethno means self, and that self could be you as an individual, you as a teacher, teacher community. It could be a group of people. And self is ethnography. Graphy is description. So description in terms of words, in terms of written documents, whatever it might be. Ethnography traces its antecedents to social anthropology and cultural anthropology. And it's a field of study that is concerned primarily with the description and analysis of culture. Now, when Krishna spoke of, when he made his presentation, he has used the word culture under the institutional CPD. And I was just relating to it there. We also have the culture of your classroom. You know, quite often the group, the ELTC group has been saying, it's part of ELTC culture, it's the spirit of ELTC, it's part of ELTC. So what is that culture? Culture, again, to put it simply, is a way of life shared by a group of people. Now, the way of life here obviously would be as a teacher, as a person in the classroom. So what is that way of life as a teacher? Well, for the teacher in the classroom and for a teacher being observed by a peer, the culture would, I wonder what the culture would mean. You know, what is the idea of culture when you are teaching in your classroom and when you are being observed? Would it be the processes that are triggered in my class? Would it be the kind of progress we've made from when I started as a young novice, you know, as a young teacher to what I am now? Is it continuing? Has it plateaued? Have I fossilized? And what is the culture of my classroom in terms of learning, learners, context, L1 students, Kannada-based students, whatever it might be. So ethnography is seen both as a process and a product, and it's an attempt for a teacher to understand the culture of his or her classroom and the whole gamut that's associated with any kind of classroom, the process, the procedures, the processes involved. So as I've said here, it's a qualitative approach. It describes, analyzes, interprets, helps us understand a group's shared belief, behaviors, and language. And when I say a group, it can be a TD group, a community of people, teaching at the same level, at the same kinds of college. It is also a holistic analytical description or reconstruction of the culture of a group. And having said that, I'm not even going to say there is a definite answer. It's just episodes of culture that we've understood, because we call something culture as it continues to evolve. It cannot reach a static point. Ethnography would be a multi-method approach that could help in the study of the culture of a classroom, reflect the knowledge of the systems, and more importantly, since this is the question that's in our minds, continuing professional development, how can we initiate and sustain CPD? And would it be an effective means of teacher empowerment? This is one analysis or one understanding of the concept of ethnography. You have ethnography at the core, because ethnography is both a process and product. And there are four important aspects of ethnography. The first one is participant observation. Then you have fieldwork, triangulation, and the last is what is called as a description of culture. Let me try and look at each of them. Neeraja and I will try and look at it together. Before we look, yes, okay, let's get on to participant observation. That was the first thing I have shown here, participant observation. Participant observation is when a teacher develops the ability to be an insider and an outsider in his or her classroom at the same time. So you are participating in your class, and you're also an observer in the class. So it could be me as a teacher teaching my class. So I'm actively engaged in the business of teaching, hopefully, right? And there are certain pockets that are distracted. So some part of me is able to stand outside and then say, now, why is that group talking? Should I do anything to change what I am doing? That would be one kind of participant observation. Another kind of participant observation would be with the peer observer. You know, when she or he is observing the class of the friend, at the same time is able to distance himself or herself and then look at it. This is something that doesn't come easily, all of us know that, but it is definitely one way of sustaining your growth. So as an insider, you're investigating, I've said social life and process. Here, of course, it means your classroom process. Your classroom becomes the cultural setting. It becomes the natural setting. And as teachers, practicing teachers, the most important part for us is the classroom. So you analyze and interpret the culture of the classroom. As an outsider, you have a special insight into what happens, because you go back to your department and then you say, this is what happened, as it usually happens in our classroom. So a teacher in the classroom is both, should develop the ability to be both an insider and an outsider. Okay, now to connect it to CPD, this is a question of interest. How do teachers create, modify, and interpret their classroom culture, which is unique to the individual teacher and context, rather than what is given and universal? I think the entire conference seems to be dealing with this, right? That's why we had Ravi Narayan in his talk when he said, do teachers and experts speak the same language? So how do we bring this fit between the culture which a teacher thinks is unique to her or his classroom and context, and what is given and universal? I'll now have Neeraja talking about that connection.
To make this transition from the heavily theoretical base that Gauri tried to start with and then brought it down to the very practical level of what happens in our actual classroom context, I think we would like to now focus on three key aspects of continuing professional development, which is the reflective practitioner, the role of the critical friend or a critical friend who may or may not be a mentor as well. Now, what we feel strongly about is that the teacher in the classroom is a participant observer of the classroom processes and practices. Now, to be a participant would mean totally involved in what is happening in the classroom situation. But to also take on this challenging role of an observer, and especially so of oneself, I think is what adds dimension to our notion of the ethnographic approach. So the teacher is reflecting in action, as it were. The teacher is reflecting on action in the same breath, as it were, and able to distance herself or himself to see or assess what has happened, to make or initiate changes that may be considered necessary, to reflect however tentatively it may be or however short term it may be, and to create or optimize the learning opportunities that may have either been planned earlier or thought of spontaneously at that point of time. So the teacher then is both an outsider, because the teacher has distanced herself from what was happening to see what repair had to be done, or what additional inputs had to be provided, or what modification had to be made to the approach, or what changes in attitudes had to be brought about. But at the same time, the teacher is the real insider, because the teacher understands or goes with a certain of one kind of understanding or one angle of understanding of what is there in the classroom that has to be met through the teaching practice. So this double perspective of the insider and the outsider is crucial to the participant observation that ethnography focuses on. And if this kind of reflection makes the participant an active participant and makes the observer an objective observer, then the self-observation process can become enriched, perhaps even later, but what is captured at that moment is a true reflection, or I should say perhaps one valid reflection of the classroom culture. To look at a complementary situation is the presence of the critical friend, who is also an outsider, as it were, because he or she is not participating actively in the teaching process, but is a very vital presence in the classroom, but at the same time playing a very supportive, very facilitative, very non-threatening kind of role. So the perspective that the critical friend brings in is very essential, because it provides a multi-pronged approach to what is happening in the classroom. And the friend can provide this opportunity by asking very provocative questions, challenging questions. But in reality, I think the hidden agenda of the observer there as a critical friend is playing the role of the devil's advocate and probing, probably putting some pressure on the teacher eventually to articulate whatever insights or sense of understanding that he or she has, so that through that process of articulation, further learning can be encouraged. So the professional approach to this can become a collaborative one, because there is a one plus one entity, as it were, in the classroom. And extending this dialogue or sharing what has occurred later on can also build a teaching community of a much larger scale or impact. So this explicitness that is made by the public talking that is encouraged by the critical friend brings in a sense of collaboration. It establishes a foundation for sustaining this kind of professional development. By and large, the teacher who is observing herself may feel a sense of isolation, because there is nobody perhaps at that point of time to share or to use as a sounding board. But the critical friend's presence, I think, helps the teacher overcome that sense of isolation and eventually can build a learning community. And the crucial role, however, of the critical friend is that the classroom culture is captured in its essence, unadulterated by the outside influence. But at the same time, after all, we always understand reality from a subjective point of view. So before the observation begins, as it were, the critical friend, and of course even the observed teacher, would lay bare their biases, their perspectives, their purposes even for the observation that takes place. So whatever thoughts are there, assumptions are there, beliefs are there about teaching and learning are brought to the fore and articulated and perhaps later built on, modified perhaps, analyzed perhaps, interpreted in different ways perhaps, but to bring it to the fore, I think, is a very crucial thing that happens during that particular moment, and that helps to give a real description of the classroom culture. However, the formality of the research that happens, I think, is important. So both the practitioner and the observer are really theorizing about the classroom through an interpretation of the classroom process. And the teacher as a researcher therefore becomes a very important dimension of the ethnographic approach. Gauri will now move on to the next phase of the presentation.
Coming to the second part of ethnography, which is field work. We talk about field work in various ways. It could be action research that is done in the classroom, your classroom research. It could be the multiple data that you have, the small notes that you've made, the jottings down, maybe the portfolio, the diary, which Neeraja will touch upon later. It could be the tape scripts. A lot of people have been talking about that. All this kind of field notes will help us look at this whole idea of ethnography. There are two things to remember with ethnography, and that is one construct of social reality. The more traditional construct of social reality is that social reality is objective, tangible, can lead to generalizations and universal laws. The second one, which is more appealing to us, is that reality is variant, subjectively perceived, and multiply constructed. So if there is an objectivity that comes in any kind of ethnographic research, it's only because the teacher in the classroom or the peer observer have made explicit the biases with which they are operating. So that is one way of bringing in objectivity into any kind of ethnographic research. The field notes would be anything that we could have, and on a more systematic basis, it would be your portfolio, your journal entries, and the rest. Artifacts, as I mentioned here, since this is from cultural anthropology, artifacts in the context of teaching learning for the teacher could be papers that have been written on it by them, observations that have been made. Maybe other people have spoken of such typical classrooms. Now, for example, when we were part of the ELTC group, for us, though we didn't know all this, we have documented quite a bit of the work that we did. And one of the things we used to do was, we used to have a plenary report, because all the special interest groups met once in 3 months, and we used to have a plenary report. And that was a flood of information. So those would become the artifacts. Things that you would have jotted down, never thought it was worth your while, it does turn out to be important later.
Okay, so the key points of CPD for this particular aspect would be classroom observation, which could be either by the self, the peer, or the group, classroom research or action research, which we've already touched upon. So I'd like to focus a little bit on the working portfolio and not so much on just the classroom diaries. Authentic data, which is essential for ethnography, would be in the form of teachers' reflections, but perhaps in the earlier stages, even the teacher's plan of action, how much of the plan has been adhered to, how much modified, what reasons there could be. So the teacher's articulation of this, both in oral and especially so in a written form, would validate the teacher's insights. So these would be a crucial part of the portfolio of the teacher, because the attitudes, the values, the beliefs, and the classroom practices based on these would find some kind of a recorded account in the portfolios. The feedback that the observer gives to would add a valuable dimension, because these notes, the jottings that are taken, are very, very much of a mirror to what is happening as perceived by the observer. Very often, the learner's perspective is ignored. So there have been occasions, as Gauri said, in some of the observation episodes that we have had together or as part of our larger teaching group, there have been occasions when learners were asked to give responses like responses to either structured or open-ended questions. And those would in turn have informed the teacher to plan the next course of action. And if that has happened, that would find its way into the portfolio. So the conscious attempt made by the teacher to reflect on the practice, to initiate changes, and to be able to rationalize those changes or express the rationale for the changes. I think that would be the better way of putting it, to give a rationale to make whatever essential changes are there, either for the methodology or for the content or for the skills or maybe techniques like classroom management. I think these are reflections and documents which will, over a period of time, help in the evaluation of the continuing professional development that this paper focuses on. Gauri?
Coming to the third part, which is triangulation. Ethnography talks about, and I'm sure all research talks about it, but I'd just like to look at that a little more in detail. You have three kinds of triangulation: the methodological one, the data, and the time triangulation. What I found fascinating about this is the need to combine various methods of teaching and learning. So it could be interactive, it could be the lecture mode, it could be your task-based, along with interviews that you might have, observations that you've made, physical evidence. Physical evidence in terms of your blue books, your papers, your internal assessment, your PowerPoint presentations, all that would become part of the methodological one. Data triangulation would be purpose of sampling. So, for instance, if I have used interview as a method, then I bring about multiple perspectives by not just interviewing one set of people, but other sets, maybe students from another class who have come here or who have friends here, an outsider. And of course, if you have the privilege of teaching a multicultural classroom in the sense of having people from different countries in your classroom, then gender, ethnicity would also become important. Time triangulation, again, is something that you do at a period of time, maybe for a couple of months, and then the continuation of it later on, maybe after another 6 months or so. So long-term and repeated observation. They feel that these are the three aspects of triangulation where the researcher himself or herself becomes the instrument of research. And that's when there is the CPD of a particular teacher and helps you understand the culture of the classroom or the kind of culture that you have in your classroom. So what would be the connection then? If you look at the ethnographic approach to CPD, then there is a kind of a dispassionate observer status as well that you give yourself, even as you are actively engaged in what you do. And the unique culture of your classroom is interpreted by the common understanding of the sets, beliefs, and knowledge and assumptions of the various people that you've spoken to, you've interacted, and the people who have given you evidence in terms of the lesson plans or the assignments that they have given you. So insiders' perceptions becomes at once the source and verification. It's just not the source, but it's also the verification. And it becomes unbiased primarily because the biases, prejudices, and values of people have been laid bare. To that extent, it becomes unbiased because you're working from the agenda of the other. So the othering has happened, and you're working from that agenda. Fieldwork then, especially in terms of peer observation, fieldwork becomes a cooperative venture between the participants. Ethnography and CPD should be a fit between the insider here, a teacher's interpretation of teaching events and processes, and understanding the significance attached to it by the larger teaching community. For instance, why are we all here trying to make sense of what other people are talking? Because there is a genuine need to identify, a genuine need to know, a genuine need to feel, this is possible. So it's very similar to what is happening in my class, or it's very different from what is happening with me. It would give an intellectual mooring, and it would also initiate procedures and practices to initiate and sustain CPD. I've tried a very ambitious kind of a diagram where I've seen, I look at CPD as central, and the teacher and the classroom is central. So that's the context. The teacher takes on many roles, and she or he is in many domains. And if they go through this whole process of participant observation, fieldwork, and triangulation, they are arriving at an ethnographic description. They're using the ethnographic tools to arrive at an ethnographic description, to arrive at what Geertz calls as the thick description of a culture. It's a way of providing cultural context, explaining the meaning to an outsider. This is what Geertz has said, and he's taken it from Max Weber, of course. Man or woman is an animal suspended in webs of significance that he himself has spun, or she herself has spun. I take culture to be those webs and the analysis of it to be, therefore, not an experimental science in search of law, but an interpretive one in search of meaning. So when we are looking for meaning, we are trying to understand the culture of our classroom. And the personal belief is the ethnographic approach is probably a suitable framework for this. Thank you for the patient hearing. I know it's the last session, and grateful that all of you are here. Thank you. I don't know whether we have time for questions, but if there is, yes. If anybody has a question, then we'll try and answer that.
Thank you, ma'am, for giving opportunity. CDP is as important as adaptation of an animal with an environment. Madam, we are here from various parts of the world. I'd like to request you to give 5 evergreen points related to CPD, which we may use at our place.
Okay, the 5 evergreen points would probably be all the CPD ones, as a reflective practitioner, as a critical friend, developing the ability to be an insider and an outsider at the same time, which is very challenging, and taking on classroom observation, action research, risking, going beyond the comfort zones of things that we know have been time-tested. I think this is CPD because, for instance, I was asked yesterday why I was not doing a workshop. And I said, no, I need to push myself out of that comfort zone and I need to do something else. A lot of people did come and ask me, your presentation is abstract. Why didn't you do a workshop? For me, I believe that you need to push yourself. You need to be a risk taker, and you need to push yourself to do things which you might not do otherwise. So that, I feel, would sustain continuing professional development. Thank you.
CPD for the teacher or CPD for the teacher trainer?
You decide. Rajagopal, I feel if it's in terms of peer observation, in the context of teacher training, I've listened very keenly to what Julu spoke of in the morning, and I think there is a fantastic CPD happening there. In the context of the EFL courses that you offer in PGCT-EDTE. So it can be CPD at the individual level and CPD at the institutional level. And I think it goes hand in hand. You cannot have CPD at the institutional level and not have CPD at the personal level. Yeah, I think Neeraja wants to add something to it.
My own experience of doing the CTE some years ago, when I was 51 actually, was it was an eye-opener, because I had tried doing it in my early 30s, and I saw this tremendous change in the approach taken by the then CIFL. And I think it's a subversive thing that the CIFL tried to do, because you had initiated this notion of CPD through the material that you sent to us. And I think the practice sessions and other activities of the contact program only strengthened it. So I think if you're doing that for the participants, it could not have happened if the educators had not seen value and also incorporated that into your style of functioning. So I don't think you need to make a distinction at all here between the teacher trainer and the teacher. Maybe we would simply say teacher educator, where the teacher is educating herself and the teacher educator is also helping the process of, say, the so-called trainees.
Thank you very much for your patient hearing, and I hope you've had a wonderful time in the conference. Thank you very much.
I just want to add one small thing that I think I should acknowledge now. Gauri said she didn't want to demonstrate, as it were, this ethnographic approach, the fact that we both presented this together months after I retired as a teacher. I retired end of September, and I came only for this presentation, only because she put that so-called positive pressure and said, you better now start thinking about making a presentation. And I enjoyed this process of taking part right from the day I interacted with her to this moment. I must thank everybody for this opportunity, and especially Gauri.